Yeah, thanks a lot for the invitation. It's definitely not my time of the day, so excuse if I'm a little bit right next to the track. I'm always really happy to speak in front of people who are dealing with IT and stuff, because I'm so much not an IT person. You saw it, I wasn't even able to start my presentation alone. I'm from Cardus. Cardus is a humanitarian NGO. It was founded 3 years ago in Berlin, and it was founded out of a kind of subculture that is strongly related to the CCC, but to the musical and festival subculture as well. And what I want to talk about today is our crisis response makerspace in Berlin. Holger invited me after we saw each other again at the Datengarten in Berlin, and he asked if I can make the presentation in English as well. My English is shit, so please excuse if I have to search some words from time to time. Do you have an idea what this is? It's a huge truck, it's a medical sign on it, so this is a kind of mobile hospital. Mobile hospital, which you can use if other hospitals are broken down, or if there are no hospitals. Do you have an idea how much such a mobile hospital would cost you to buy? 3 million, 2 million, 3 million, 4 million. This is a picture of a destroyed hospital in Syria. So you all see a lot of pictures in the TV and stuff like that. Can you relate these 3 to 4 million mobile hospital to this destroyed mobile hospital? Do you normally see in the media that if a hospital is destroyed, that this fancy stuff is deployed to there? Do you have an idea why? It's fucking expensive. Something more? Who's going to pay for that? Is help wanted more? It's a question of safety from time to time. But on top, you have to imagine Syria, war country, dust, heat, no supply chain, nothing like that. So bringing there a 4 million mobile hospital might end in 2 weeks of working. And after that, nothing is working anymore because you don't have the technicians who can repair this kind of stuff, for example. Next example, I'm sure you know what this is. It's a pretty fancy fire truck. You have them in Germany in all the bigger villages and all the cities, stuff like that. If you take a look inside these fire trucks, you see plenty of fancy stuff. I love this stuff. There's stuff to put out fires. There's stuff to lift things with hydraulics. There is normal stuff like shovels and stuff like that. But if you relate this to pictures in disaster areas, this is from Haiti, then you see that you have plenty of people, but no equipment at all. Or it's pretty clear, because normally after a disaster, people from all over the world come as fast as possible to the disaster area, the so-called urban search and rescue teams. They're coming by plane, so all the fancy stuff that we have in our society stays here, and a few people that typically white knights of humanitarian aid go to the disaster areas to help the poor people. You understand this was cynical. And there's a third example. Have you ever seen what this is? This is a tourniquet. Basically, a tourniquet is 1 meter of nylon strap and a little bit of plastic. Tourniquet is the best way to stop severe bleeding immediately. We know this since the Second World War, at least since 20 years, it's totally clear and it's validated. This is the best way to stop severe bleeding. Spoiler, you won't see this in the media. If you see like people in Syria getting hurt, like losing the legs after explosion and stuff like that. Do you have an idea how expensive is such a thing? 1 meter of nylon, little piece of plastic? Not so expensive, but it goes in this direction. $55 for one of these. $55 for fucking 1 meter of nylon strap. And I don't know, less than 10 grams of plastic. And the last example, I don't know if you have a pet. I had a dog. If I would like to, I could add a GPS to my dog, and this GPS will say when my dog is sleeping, where my dog is, where I can find my dog, if it's gone, stuff like that. But again, if you went to Haiti directly after the earthquake, people searched for other people in collapsed building with their bare hands. So obviously, we have a lot of technical solutions for everything. I can look for my fucking dog in Hamburg where it is via my app on my iPhone. But on the other hand, in a disaster area, it's not even possible to search people who are buried in collapsed buildings. There are several reasons for that. One reason, humanitarian work, humanitarian aid is a market. This is a little bit perverted, but it is a market. It's always a question. It's not like who wants to help, but who pays for the help, who gets his share out of this help. And you can imagine we have, I don't know, every 2 or 3 years a major earthquake. So the market, if you compare it to a normal business market, is pretty small. Who cares for the 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 people who die in an earthquake every 3 years? The next thing, access to the market. Is it possible to bring things to Syria? Why should I develop, as a businessman in capitalism, why should I develop something if I can't reach my market easily? So, to make my share. And the third thing, who are the players on the market? In humanitarian aid, most players are NGOs. NGOs are not really interested in developing new things, because if I have an NGO, a classical NGO, then I like the thing how they are. If there is a disaster, I send my people, I make some nice pictures for the media, and I get a lot of donations. I'm not interested in changing things. If I would like building capacity in local communities so much that they don't need me anymore after disasters, then there's no need for my nice white NGO anymore. So these three things together make a situation where you have a lot of solutions in our communities and our societies, but you have no possibility to bring this to disaster aid. We started 2014 in northern Syria, more or less by accident. We were asked if we could come with a political delegation and make an overview of the medical infrastructure. And ever since, we were stuck in this region. Because we saw no NGOs working there, because the states were not really willing to pay money for that, because northeast Syria is ruled by some Kurdish militias, and these Kurdish militias are too lefty to get money from states, let's say it this way. So we saw a situation there, and we still had an old four-wheel driven truck here in Germany, and we said, this would be great if we just built out of this truck a mobile hospital. We had no idea how to do this. We were really a little bit naive in these times. We said, just that, like, it's a nice truck. There's a lot of space in this truck, so let's build it. We have an idea. We have a fantasy. We will go with this truck to northern Syria. Then we will give it to a local NGO, and then they have a mobile hospital to follow the front lines in their fight against the so-called Islamic State. And 2 years later, 2 years later, we really were in northern Iraq, not northern Syria so far, but in northern Iraq with our mobile hospital. And this time it was pretty hard to cross the border to Syria, so we had to stay in northern Iraq. So we asked the WHO, the World Health Organization, what can we do right now? We are here, we have a mobile hospital. Do you see any need for us? And they said, yeah, guys, if you would like to, then we would like to send you to Mosul. And I don't know if you saw in the media the last year, the Battle of Mosul was one of the most bloody and the most shitty battles that we had in the past 20, 30 years, I think, with a lot of civilian casualties. And we said, okay, let's try. We built this mobile hospital. Let's see if it's working. And we were able to work like 1.5, 2 kilometers behind the front line of the Islamic State. And we were really wondering because we were really surprised because we saw like nobody else was working there because they just didn't have the equipment for that. Because they had either to buy a mobile hospital for $3-4 million. Nobody had that. And other things were not available on the market. So we were the only ones working there. And over the few months that we worked directly at the front line, we treated several thousand people with this. And this was actually the moment when the crisis response makerspace was born. So it was not planned that we build up this makerspace. It was just like we had the workshop in Berlin where we fixed the truck, where we renovated the truck and stuff like that. And after we went to Iraq, we just said like, this was a pretty good idea and it worked out pretty well. We are sure there were more problems that have to be solved in humanitarian crisis. And actually this first mobile hospital went over the border to Syria like 1 week ago. So now it is in Rojava, where it should have gone to. What we're doing at the moment, we have some lessons learned out of this first mobile hospital, and we're developing a second mobile hospital because the first one was based on old trucks that we could get really cheap in Germany. But our idea was always like we would like to create open source blueprints for local NGOs so that they can copy our solutions that we develop. With these German trucks, it's not really easy. We can't go to an NGO in the Middle East and say like, hey, look, this is how we build it, because they can't get their hands on these German trucks. So now we use UC containers because you can get them everywhere in the world. They are unbelievable cheap. You can get them for 2,500 euros. And so at the moment in Berlin, we are building on something like this. It's not to work inside the containers, but to have an inflatable tent structure coming out of the container. And then you have your 20 treatment places, and we're working on different solutions that are not existing at the moment. Like these patient treatment places are based on flight cases and stuff like that. So we try to bring together our experiences from the musical subculture, from organizing festivals, from building up structures pretty fast in empty rooms and stuff like that, together with these humanitarian problems. Another problem that I had at the beginning was this fire truck, when I said like no fire trucks in disaster areas. And we thought like, although we can't get our hands on these fire trucks, a fire truck is basically just a truck with a good solution how to store your equipment so that you can use your equipment when it's still on the truck and you have your engine running and you have your electricity and stuff like that. So we were thinking like, okay, you don't need this fire truck, you just need a box system that you can bring with normal airplanes to disaster areas and then put it on normal pickups, because pickups, you find them all over the world. For this, we would need a kind of box system that you can connect in three angles. And we took a look on the market, and again, it's not necessary normally to have something like this, so nobody developed this in a meaning that you can load these boxes with up to 200 kilo. So we developed a new kind of box. It won't have the name Carbox in the future, but we were not, couldn't find another. This box is like a modular system. We tried to work together with universities. This was together with the HTW in Berlin. And this is how things are done with us. We have first an idea, just like how can we cut a fire truck in pieces, bring it to a disaster area and put it together again. And out of this process, there are coming more and more ideas. Then we saw like, yes, perhaps it's not only like connecting these boxes, perhaps it's an idea to make it in a modular way, because then you can define for every side of the box a special use, like for example photovoltaic. And now we have a box developed that you can put in a normal airplane, bring it to a disaster area, just turn around the boxes, the side of the boxes, and you have electricity and, for example, inside a water pump or something like that. When we then thought about, Okay, but how can we get into the disaster areas if the roads are blocked? Stuff like that. We saw this in Nepal after the earthquake. We saw this on Puerto Rico last year after the typhoon, that the help couldn't reach the island. We thought about it's not so difficult to throw things out of airplanes. So again, we took a look at the market and said, like, wow, no civilian solutions to throw huge payloads out of aircrafts. The solutions on the markets are military solutions. So the UN can use it, but normally it's up to the national military who can use it. The only solution we could find was a box system coming from an English company. And with this box, you can throw out, I think, up to 70 kilo, but only like things that can't break. You can't throw out medical instruments with this. So what we did, because again, we looked like who could be the best person to talk with us about something like that. And we thought it's not the military, obviously, because they think in bigger scales, they think in endless money, they think in endless logistics. So we got together with paragliders from Switzerland, who we met in the refugee response in the Mediterranean, and told them, we would like to throw things out of airplanes. What do you think about it? And they said, why not? We are jumping out of airplanes all the time. So why should it be so difficult? What came out is that every paraglider who goes down a mountain in Switzerland, like frequently daily, has an emergency parachute in his paraglide. And this emergency parachute has to be renewed every 3 years. Not because it's broken, but because we're living in a rich society and insurances say, like, if you don't do this, I won't insurance you. So you have plenty of hundreds, thousands of used parachutes that are totally okay. And you can hang, obviously, more than 100 kilo on them. Then you have these tandem parachutes, you can obviously hang more than 250 kilogram on them. So what we did, totally legal. We tried it out and threw some things from really high bridges in Switzerland with these parachutes. And then we saw, yeah, it's functioning. So next thing was that we developed a kind of absorption with carton. And the funny thing, when we went to Switzerland and said to the officials and said, like, yeah, you know, we are a bunch of punk rock idiots working in humanitarian aid, but we have this idea we could throw things out of normal parachuting machines because you can find them all over the world, because all over the world people do this sport. And it's pretty cheap, and we could reach like valleys that are non-reachable yet. They said, like, do you know what the problem is? Every country has to have this airdrop capacity. This is like a, I don't know, regularly from the international air travel, something, something. And they said, we in Switzerland, we solve this again with the military. We have to pay like 24,000 euro an hour to do this because we do it with big helicopters. You offer us a solution that if it's working out, it's working with like 2,000 euro an hour. So they said, if your system is working, you will be immediately assigned as an official humanitarian airdrop capacity in Switzerland. So this is like we started 1.5 years ago in an old, what's called S-Bahnbogen building in Berlin to renew old trucks, to bring them to Northern Syria. And then we thought, like, let's use this space, let's look for solutions for humanitarian problems. And the idea was in the beginning just to bring together nerds, geeks, people out of the field, refugees who knows best what will help them in the crisis, specialists, universities, stuff like that. And what started like, let's see if it could happen, comes out as this year in July, we will throw out some boxes with parachutes out of airplanes and will perhaps have the first worldwide airborne emergency response unit. So yes, we saw there was a big need for the things. At the moment, we don't have a lot of IT projects. We have some ideas, and we would like to, to grow our network because we have nerds from the CCC sitting around there. But at the moment, they love to do something with wood. So at the moment, it's a. But the makerspace is a makerspace like you know it. You have an open space. Everybody could come in. We have only the regulatory that we say like everything that is developed should be with a focus on humanitarian aid, and everything that we develop has to be open source so that people can use it worldwide. If you would like to get in contact with us, www.cardus.org. We have all this fancy stuff like Facebook, Twitter, and that you can find it on the homepage. Thank you very much for your attention, and this was it.
Talk. Thanks a lot for the great talk. Other questions?
Hi, thank you for the talk. I'm not sure if you know about an organization. I think it's only French at the moment, which is called HAND, which is Hackers Against Natural Disasters. Uh-huh. And it's basically a non-profit which tries to help local populations in case of natural disasters. Yeah. So mostly they were in for the typhoon last year in French islands in the Caribbean. Mm-hmm. And they try to set up some kind of infrastructures, IT infrastructures. So there are ham radios, and they try to set up internet and stuff like that, so people can actually use communications. They try to set up like 3G networks, and they, I think it's only French, but they have a great, I don't know a lot about them, but I think they have a quite hacker spirit. Mm-hmm. And might be cooperation, an helpful cooperation with you.
This would be perfect, right? Thank you very much. There are actually a lot of groups like this worldwide. For example, we are now part of the GIG, that's called the Global Innovation Gathering, which are like 50 makerspaces all over the world. So there are small organizations that are really interesting. The problem is it's hard to find your space in this humanitarian world because the big organizations really close down the access to this, the access to bigger amounts of money and stuff like that. So contacts are always welcome because I think we can only reach something if we form better and bigger networks.
In areas of crisis and especially in war, it's hard to understand which interests are on which side, or are there any goods in this? How do you avoid to become a useful idiot?
I think I don't avoid it. And humanitarians are a kind of useful idiots. In the humanitarian sector, there are two main pictures about humanitarian aid. It was Henri Dunant, who founded the Red Cross, who said, like, yes, there is a war. Yes, obviously, these are assholes that they shoot at each other. But in the end, they are humans. So once they're laying down on the floor, they deserve to be treated like humans. I know that if I treat him and he's fit again, perhaps he goes out again and shoot again. And there was the other person, Florence Nightingale, in the same time. She said, like, humanitarian aid should mean only these people get humanitarian aid who bond themselves to these humanitarian principles. So a soldier that got shot down, I won't treat him if I'm not sure that he won't go out again. In the meanwhile, I think the humanitarian world sticks totally to this, to the model of Dunant. And for us, it's the same. I treated people who fought for ISIS in Mosul, definitely. Because in my opinion, if I go there and say, like, I am the medic and the judge at the same time, then it's really strange. There have to be other people to judge over this. So as a humanitarian aid worker, you are a little bit a helpful idiot all the way. The other discussion is definitely a question about if humanitarian aid brings anything, or if it's just like a machine that tries to run itself again and again and again and again, like this help industry. This we try to avoid with not playing after the same rules. So we are not into, I don't know, every 2 or 3 years there is a new theme that you have to serve. Like, for example, now it's capacity building in war zones. We think it's pretty easy. We don't have to follow these rules of the humanitarian sector, humanitarian market. We stuck to the humanitarian ideals, and we always try to work together with the locals. And yes, for sure, you always have locals who try to have their share out of this crisis. But if you talk to the locals, talk to different locals, to work with several organizations together, you will see who is really working on the ground just to help the people. And we try to support these. And like I said, we don't produce or develop solutions that we can sell. It's all open source. So I hope this helps to avoid a little bit to support the wrong people.
Any further questions?
Hi, awesome work. Have you considered 3D printing to maybe come up with spare parts or let the community?
Sorry, again?
Have you considered 3D printing?
Yes, there are actually organizations who are doing this. There's one really cool organization, it's called Field Ready. They're developing a database with a lot of things like the small thing you need to stop the connection between a mother and the baby. I don't know what the name is in English. And they develop a database so that people can print these medical devices in disaster areas, what's pretty cool. We at the moment, we tried like a few months ago to get our hands on 3D printers, but then it's so expensive at the moment, and we are just more experienced with metal and steel and stuff like that. But we looked into this, and in the moment it's just like we are always doing too much, unfortunately. I wanted to buy one, and then our colleagues from CCC said, "Don't do that. You're not clever enough, so you will destroy it. Wasted money." But actually, for the tourniquet, for example, there is a solution as well for 3D printing. I just read an article a few days ago. So I think 3D printing is a kind of really close connected to the future of humanitarian aid, definitely.
Any further questions?
It's last question, more comment. So, because you showed that, yeah, we have this cool, sexy solutions for technology, for finding dogs, and in less developed countries we have problems, but it looks like we have problems with disasters in all the world. Look at what happened in New Orleans. Look what is still happening in Puerto Rico, which is supposedly first world country, but is still have problems with electricity. So it's not that there are good countries and bad countries, but we have problems with all those global solutions to recover.
Yeah.
But that's totally. I think that's good approach that to get local people to organize and to try to solve, because they know what is needed most.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Totally. I think this is a fucked up thing about capitalism. If I live in a nice, decent city like Hamburg and I have a dog, I will easily spend 10 euro a month for an app to find my dog, but I don't relate to the thing that I could be under some rubbish as well, so I won't pay for a disaster app or something like that, because it's not part of my daily life. So no company will be willing to develop something like this. It's just like the rules of the market. Silly, but it is like it is. Okay. Thank you very much for your attention.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Sebastian again.